Children! Ah, it seems that someone else has decided to peer into the Longbox out of season. Well, how fitting that we are changing up the format today, because today's comic is no longer available in physical form. What's scarier than a Whelan that traumatized you as a kid? And Disney has no shortage of those, whether it was Maleficent, Jafar, Ursula, Frollo, or even Lady Tremaine. These movies are so well known that frankly I'd be more surprised if you hadn't seen them. What? Martin loves Disney! After all, it is the happiest place on earth for you, my children. However, did you know that there was another Disney Whelan whose power rivals even theirs? Back in the pre-internet days, everything had a magazine. And Disney was no exception. They had a digest-sized magazine called Disney Adventures. And of course, because it was a magazine for kids, it had comics in it. They were all fairly good as far as kid stuff goes, and Disney knew they were the main attraction, even publishing standalone comic books on occasion. However, one such comic was never reprinted, even though it truly deserves to be. An epic crossover that spanned five of their series. The Legend of the Chaos God. Yes, back in 1994, writer Bobby J. Weiss and illustrator Cosme Quartieri wrote a five-part story arc that features Disney characters fighting the return of an ancient god of chaos. It ran for five issues from July to December of that year. It was delayed for a few issues after the first story due to the imprinting and comic adaptation of The Lion King. The running fan theory is that it was most likely to commemorate the 50th issue, but due to the aforementioned Lion King comic, the conclusion was actually in the 51st issue. Whoops. But enough of that boring technical stuff you don't care about. Let us take a journey into the tale of the Chaos God. Part 1, Crystal Chaos, begins in the world of Tailspin, where the crew of Hire for Hire are going on a delivery for Baloo's friend Professor Potsherd. Apparently, the professor unearths some ancient artifacts from the Temple of Doom and Gloom, the last remnant of the Rock and Ruin civilization, which disappeared many years ago under mysterious circumstances. Following a skirmish with Don Carnage and his air pirates, because it would not be Tailspin without a dogfight, two artifacts get knocked free from one of the crates. A necklace with an enormous ruby ends up inside of an old supply barrel, and the gold setting for the ruby falls into the ocean. Unfortunately, before we get to the interesting stuff, we have to suffer through some annoying character interaction between Baloo, Molly, and Molly's mother, Becky. Because how dare Baloo chase away pirates while Becky is on board? One wonders why she felt the need to send her daughter along with them in the first place, especially given how often Baloo tangles with Don Carnage. However, it doesn't take too long for Becky to knock over the barrel in the supply room. And once she picks up the necklace, she is possessed by the ancient chaos god, Solego. According to the spirit, it needs the necklace's gold setting to become whole again, and it believes the sea duck is the perfect vehicle to do it with. Luckily, the crew can tell that something is wrong with her, but when she takes off in the plane, Baloo and the kids end up hanging on for dear life. Becky's love for her daughter is enough to fight off the control of the malevolent god, and with their help, she's able to get the necklace off, and disposes of it in the ocean, where the gold setting is. Whoops. I will admit, my children, the first issue of this story is probably the weakest, but stick with it, and your patience will be rewarded. Part 2, To Half and Half Not, follows Chippendale's Rescue Rangers. A fisherman ends up scooping up the ruby containing Solego in his fishing net, for some reason without the chain attached to it, but that's a nitpick, and the voice of the Dark God convinces him to turn it into a museum. We cut to the Rescue Rangers taking out the museum, for Fat Cat and his minions have come to steal the gold setting, which somehow found its way to the same museum. Also, according to this plaque, the artifacts from the temple were unearthed 50 years ago. So does this mean that Tailspin takes place 50 years before Rescue Rangers? The Disney afternoon timeline is weird, my children. The Rescue Rangers mess up their plan by triggering the fire alarm, but Fat Cat still gets hold of the setting. However, during the skirmish, our heroes come across the ruby containing Solego, which soon possesses Dale. The rest of this issue is basically the two sides playing keep away with both halves of a medallion, though it is made more interesting by the museum flooding as well as the various inventions our small heroes end up barreling their way through. Fat Cat very nearly puts the medallion together at the end, but his app from a nearby Tesla coil stops him. The end of this issue shows the Rescue Rangers sending off the two halves of the medallion in two different directions with their crow couriers Edgar and Alan, with Gadget hoping that they'll never end up seeing those medallion pieces again. Quoth the Raven! Probably. Part 3, Spookus Ex Machina, follows the cast of Goof Troop, but it starts with Edgar the Crow accidentally dropping the ruby from the medallion, now with the chain attached to it again, into the grill of a car going down the highway. Said car turns out to be Pete's latest purchase, a car with a computerized brain. This sequel to Knight Rider is weird. However, even Goofy can tell that something is off about the vehicle. But nothing seems to go wrong at first when Pete takes Peg out for a drive. Later that night, however, Solego, while still inside the ruby, puts his plan into action by sending a plug from the car into Goofy's house. By the way, I love how they imply that Goofy's watching Darkwing Duck on TV here. Anyway, he uses the TV news to find out that the medallion's gold setting has been found in a pawn shop where Scrooge McDuck bought it. Considering that Gadget told Alan to drop it in the sewer, I sincerely hope the pawnbroker washed it off first. Solego resolves to go to Duckburg, but even he cannot move the car without the key. And Goofy, seeing the plug, tries to warn Pete that his car is alive. This backfires, however, as it gets Pete out of the house so Solego can use the car's window washing arms and capture the two, forcing them to take him to Duckburg. I hear you knocking, but you can't come in. Fortunately, Solego does not know the limits of his new body and ends up going off a cliff, with Goofy and Pete jumping free just in time. However, Solego is able to dial for a towing service, which takes us to part 4, Tow for Broke. The wrecked car ends up in Duckburg, with Scrooge refusing to pay for the tow from Spooner Wiz since Solego used his name to do it. But Fenton Crackshell hears the voice of Solego from inside, which leads to him getting possessed by Solego's ruby. And, as everyone who's watched DuckTales knows, Fenton Crackshell is also the superhero known as Gizmo Duck. Solego takes control of the Gizmo Duck armor, quickly kicks Fenton out, and heads for Scrooge's money bin. But Scrooge's nephews see him going there.
Danger, watch behind you!
Solego in his new robot body is able to break through the money bin easily, but does not find the gold setting. But despite setting off every alarm in the place, he merely flees with the police in tow. Luckily, the boy's junior woodchuck guidebook has information on absolutely anything you can think of, including the Chaos God himself. The two find the professor, or rather his son, and we finally learn the story of the mysterious Chaos God. Apparently, Solego is no god, but rather a powerful ancient sorcerer who nearly conquered the world with his magic, only getting the name Chaos God because it was bad luck to say his name. But a warrior named Deshane somehow managed to split Solego into two, imprisoning his mind inside the ruby and his powers inside the gold setting. Knowing that if the two halves were ever reunited, the sorcerer could escape once more, he sealed away the ruby and setting inside a block of magic-resistant jade. One would think that if you truly wanted to keep the two halves from being reunited, you would send both halves to two different parts of the world, but hey, Muerte is not an ancient warrior alchemist. The professor took the medallion and setting out of the jade block for study, fastening the disappearing chain to the ruby for handling, but, well, we all know what happened from there. However, as Scrooge said, the medallion is not in his money bin. He sent it to his jeweler in St. Canard to be cleaned. Scrooge now knows that only one person can stop Solego in the Gizmo Duck armor, and contacts the secret agency Shush to warn Darkwing Duck. This takes us to the finale in Part 5, Rain and Thunder. Fenton arrives in St. Canard as Darkwing Duck is told about the necklace, warning him that the necklace must be kept safe.
I also like that they acknowledge that Launchpad used to be employed by Scrooge, but is now working with Darkwing Duck. This comic did a cinematic universe years before Marvel did it. But Solego is one step ahead of our hero, arriving at the jeweler and getting the setting. Darkwing arrives to stop him, but he gets his tail handed to him thanks to the Gizmo Duck suit. And at long last, the Chaos God Solego is freed from his imprisonment. He starts causing, well, chaos over St. Canard, bringing objects to life to terrorize the citizens. He even brings two stone lions to life to attack DW. However, Fenton, having recovered the Gizmo Duck suit when Solego got his new body, is able to stop the lions before Solego blows the suit up. However, Darkwing Duck is victorious through sheer dumb luck. As Solego is busy toying with him, he accidentally hits a reflective satellite dish, sending his own magic back at him and once again entrapping him in the medallion. As it turns out, Deshane was able to do the same by reflecting his magic off his polished shield centuries ago. But regardless of how it happened, the professor's son is able to place the necklace back inside the suppressing jade block, which they place inside a safe, and conceal said safe in the bottom of Scrooge's money bin, where Solego would never be rediscovered again. Actually, given that there were no more stories featuring him, perhaps Scrooge's money bin is more secure than we were led to believe. The Legend of the Chaos God is the crossover you never knew you wanted from the Disney afternoon shows of your childhood. It is not a perfect comic, my children. For example, I'm still wondering what happened to the chain during the second chapter, and it is a bit strange that Tailspin takes place 50 years before the other Disney afternoon shows. And the ending is a bit anticlimactic, but these were never particularly action-oriented shows, so it feels natural for it to end that way. I admit that I personally would have liked to have seen more of Darkwing Duck, but that's just me. But none of those keep it from being an entertaining and well-drawn comic. It makes me wonder why Disney never tried to do anything like this in the actual shows. Perhaps due to rights issues or something like that. But that is what comic books are for, is it not? As I said before, The Legend of the Chaos God was never reprinted, but it still has loyal fans to this day that placed it on the internet. And sadly, because Disney rarely promotes or releases shows that have since gone off the air, it is not likely that we'll ever hear from the Chaos God again. But at least you can always count on me to be here, my children. All you need to do is open up the long box and see what crawls out.
I was working in the lab late one night when my eyes beheld a new sight. When the monster from its lab began to rise, and suddenly, to my surprise,
he did the mash.
He did the monster mash.
Monster mash.
It was a graveyard smash.
He did the mash.
It caught on a flash.
Monster mash.
It's called the Monster Mash.
Wow.
Laboratory in the castle needs.
Wow.
Master bedroom where the vampire sleeps.
Wow.
The ghouls have came from their amulet.
Wow.
You get a jerk from my electrode.
They did the mash.
They did the Monster Mash.
The Monster Mash.
It was a graveyard smash.
They did the mash.
Caught on the
Monster Mash.
It's called the Monster Mash.